Good afternoon. I'm now calling this hearing to order. I am Policy Committee Vice Chairman Stephen Kinsey. Policy Committee Chairman Mike Sterla has asked me to run this meeting while he participates remotely. For everyone's information, this hearing is being recorded and utilizing Microsoft Teams software for remote testifiers and members. Those joining us remotely must turn off their cameras and mute their microphones until called upon to speak. The public is watching this hearing live at www.pahouse.com/live. Now I'm going to have for the members who are in this room to introduce themselves, and we'll start at my far left.
Tom Calagirone, 127th District, City of Reading. Thank you, Chair.
Great. Bill Hohenstein, 177th District, and
A co-chair of the Pennsylvania Welcoming Caucus.
Representative Mary Isaacson, 175th District, Philadelphia County.
Good afternoon. Mark Longetti, I represent the 7th District in Mercer County.
Good afternoon, Representative Chris Sinod, I represent the 9th District in Lawrence County.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Bill Kortz from the 38th District, Allegheny County.
Thank you all for being here with us this afternoon. I also want to make the members that are present as well as the general public aware that we are being joined remotely by Chairman Frankel, by Representative McClinton, Representative Allman, Representative Hambridge, Representative Malagari, Representative O'Mara, Representative Rabb, Representative Donatucci, Representative Green, Representative Webster, Representative Matzey, and Representative Sanchez. At this moment, I'm going to ask our co-host, who is joining us remotely, Chairman Frankel, for his opening remarks.
Thank you, Chairman Kinsey. Can everybody hear me okay? I heard a little bit of feedback, but so I want to thank all of our speakers today and my colleagues. We have quite a good turnout of members to talk about this important issue. And I want to specifically thank Chairman Kinsey, not only in his role as Vice Chairman of the Policy Committee, but also in his role as Chairman of the House Black Caucus here in Harrisburg, who was instrumental in helping to put this together along with his staff, and also to my colleague Joe Hohenstein, who is the chair of the Welcoming Pennsylvania Caucus that is looking into issues around immigrants and undocumented immigrants in our communities and the issues that they face, and that's clearly also a topic today. We put this hearing together very quickly and after getting some preliminary data that was pretty disturbing and that we really feared was coming, that we've heard from other communities across the country. As we suspected, Black and brown people are twice as likely to contract COVID-D compared with white people in North America. Non-white people are also more likely to require hospitalization due to COVID-19 and twice as likely to die. All of these stats hold up for Pennsylvania, as well as they hold up for my community in Allegheny County in the city of Pittsburgh. These numbers, while both shocking, are not surprising. Health disparities are nothing new for communities of color, and every time a health threat hits this country or this state, it is these communities that will be hit first, and they are hit the hardest. The factors that led us to this place are many: poor and declining access to health care, too few worker protections, a lack of trust in government, the high cost of childcare, and the lack of affordable housing are just a few of these factors. Just this week, we learned that the country has seen the largest single loss of health coverage ever. 5.4 million workers have become uninsured because of job losses. If we don't act quickly and boldly, these disparities will tend to widen and become harder to mitigate. Conversely, if we can address those issues head on, providing all Pennsylvanians with the things they need in order to take care of themselves and get the help they require, the quality of life for all will go up for everyone. I want to congratulate the Pennsylvania's Health Department for leading the way in terms of collecting data on sexual orientation and gender identity as recommended by the administration's Health Disparity Task Force. We need to know where the problems are so that we can address them. We will discuss a small slice of a much larger problem. And I want to assure everyone who is joining us that addressing health disparities among marginalized populations is a top priority of the Democratic chairman of the Health Committee. And as I know, it is for all the other lawmakers who are here with us today. Your zip code should not determine your life expectancy, and neither should it your ethnicity, your country of origin, your sexual orientation, or your gender identity. Again, I look forward to hearing from the folks who will be testifying today, and I'm very grateful that they were so enthusiastically responsive on such short notice. And again, to thank Chairman Kinsey and Chair Hohenstein for their work and with their staffs to help put this together today. So I'll turn it back over to Chairman Kinsey.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman Frankel. And now we hear from Vice Chair Rep. Hohenstein.
Thank you, Rep. Kinsey, and thank you also to Representative Frankel for inviting me and the Welcoming PA Caucus to be a part of this. And I just want to uplift all of the messages that Rep. Frankel just provided. And for us and the folks working on in the Welcoming PA Caucus on immigrant issues, I think we're paying special attention to what happens when people are disconnected because of documentation or legal status issues, and what that what factors we have to be, adding into the equation when we get out into those communities to make sure that they're served as well. And just looking forward, as I said before, to giving some voice to the voiceless with this hearing and a platform for us to hear from the people who have been most affected by this COVID pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Hohenstein. Before we begin, I also want to make sure that we recognize and thank Chairman Sterla. This policy hearing would not be made possible had it not been for the hard work and efforts of Chairman Sterla's staff, along with my staff and members of the Pennsylvania Legislative Black Caucus. I want to thank all the staff for putting this together. Also want to recognize and thank Governor Tom Wolf. I think that many of us are aware that earlier this year, Governor Wolf had established the Health Equity Response Team. That committee, to my understanding, have been meeting on a monthly basis, gathering facts and information. And it is our hope that once we hear the testifiers, we have some additional information that we can share with the governor and that task force to help prevent the societal inequalities that exist, particularly among communities that are largely black and brown. So with that being said, we're going to begin our policy hearing. Members, I'm going to ask that for each of you that have questions, that you hold off until the panel has finished testifying, and we will recognize you, those that are here as well as those remotely who have questions. And so we'll begin with hearing from Hannah Hardy. Hannah Hardy, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
All right. I understand that you're going to read Dr. Bogan's testimony. Is that correct?
That's correct, yes. I will read her testimony, and then I have testimony as well.
Great.
But I will start with Dr. Bogans, yes.
Great. If you can begin with Dr. Bogans. Thank you very much for being here as well.
Thank you very much. I will do that. Good afternoon, Chairman Sterla and members of the House Democratic Policy Committee. Thank you for this opportunity to participate in this hearing on COVID-19 disparities, and thank you to Representative Frankel for the invitation to offer testimony to you today on this very important issue. Across the United States, Pennsylvania, and Allegheny County, COVID-19 continues to disproportionately impact communities of color, and we applaud this committee and our partners throughout the state for pursuing policy strategies to protect the state's most vulnerable. Like many other jurisdictions, Allegheny County has health outcome disparities that exist along racial and ethnic lines, such as maternal and infant mortality. Communities throughout this country are starkly divided along racial and ethnic lines. With these lines come distinct differences in access to social determinants of health, including employment, housing, education, and transportation. These differences translate directly to worse health outcomes among our communities of color and has only been amplified in our current pandemic. While Allegheny County did not see the glaring racial and ethnic disparities in COVID-19 related outcomes during the early months of the pandemic, we have become increasingly worried about trends that have started to surface. For instance, despite making up only 13% of our population, as of last week, our Black population has accounted for 24% of positive cases, 31% of hospitalizations, and 31% of ICU admissions, and tragically, 20% of COVID-19 deaths. The Allegheny County Health Department is committed to pursuing strategies that mitigate these inequities and will continue to take action locally to make COVID-19 disparities data available to inform the emergency response work of the county and our partners. We are also committed to making sure meaningful access to testing, treatment, and other medical advancements for our communities of color is a priority for our county. We are committed to collecting and sharing information on race in our COVID-19 data so that we can understand and address the impact of the virus in different communities. We are also working with the county's Department of Human Services, service providers, and other local partners to develop strategies to increase healthcare services for many of our high-risk communities. Through local partnerships, we have developed supportive programming to address COVID-19 and associated morbidities for communities with a high proportion of people of color. Perhaps most notably, our health department has worked with 16 federally qualified health centers throughout Allegheny County to develop a community-based testing approach. These partnerships with local FQHCs have allowed Allegheny County to greatly increase the number of locations that are conducting COVID-19 testing, as well as target sites in neighborhoods where we have seen disproportionate rates of the illness. Black people account for 30% of the tests administered by FQHCs. At all testing locations countywide, Black people account for 15%. As our state and local surveillance efforts reveal more on how this virus spreads throughout our communities, we must use these findings to inform our work to protect vulnerable minority communities. Disparate rates of underlying conditions, such as diabetes and high blood pressure, undoubtedly play a role in terms of the risk for developing severe illness from COVID-19. However, higher rates of positive cases in communities of color cannot be explained by such predispositions. There is growing evidence that demonstrates the pandemic's impact on communities of color is driven by factors that increase the likelihood of exposure. Our Black and Latino residents are more likely to live in multi-generational homes and work in jobs where telecommuting is simply not an option. These characteristics of our most vulnerable communities must shape state and local strategies in this pandemic. For instance, as we learn of increasing rates among our younger population in the weeks following business reopening activities, we must consider how this impacts densely populated communities where young adults are likely to live with older family members who more likely to develop severe illness. We must also continue to be vigilant in enforcing reopening measures designed to protect our frontline workers and other essential employees of all racial and ethnic backgrounds, as they are more likely to come from low-income communities. Again, I thank the House Democratic Policy Committee for this opportunity to share our perspective, and I welcome future opportunities to ensure pursuing health equity during the COVID-19 pandemic remains a priority for the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. That is the end of Dr. Bogan's testimony.
Thank you very much for that. We're going to, if you don't mind, we'll just go directly into your testimony now, and then we'll have one other testifier, and then we'll ask the members if they have any questions for the first panel. Thank you.
Thank you. I will continue. So my name is Hannah Hardy. I am the director of the Chronic Disease and Injury Prevention Program at the Allegheny County Health Department. Thank you very much for the opportunity to address this committee on the COVID-19 disparities. Good afternoon to the members of the committee and to Representative Frankel for the invitation to provide testimony. Dr. Bogan's testimony addressed the issues with COVID-19 and associated morbidities for communities with a high proportion of people of color. One of the factors she cited are the disparate rates of underlying conditions such as chronic diseases. The Allegheny County Health Department is working in collaboration with a number of partners to address underlying health conditions to reduce health disparities in Allegheny County. The onset and severity of chronic diseases such as diabetes, heart disease, or cancer are complex. Having a family history of a disease plays a role, but social factors such as employment, education, access to healthcare services, safe and inexpensive places for physical activity, and the ability to shop for healthier foods like fruits and vegetables are also very important determinants of health. These social and economic factors may also influence personal behaviors that add to the risk for chronic diseases, such as tobacco use, a diet high in fat and sodium, and little to no physical activity, sometimes because of very limited free time. As I mentioned, the Allegheny County Health Department is working with local and national partners to address health disparities in predominantly African American communities. I would highlight one of our key partners, Dr. Tiffany Gary Webb from the University of Pittsburgh. She is an active partner and key strategic partner in the project that I'm going to speak about. She's speaking later on in the next panel. The REACH program, Racial and Ethnic Approaches to Community Health, is a Centers for Disease Control funded initiative, is one example of a program that aims to achieve health equity and prevent chronic diseases in the East End of Pittsburgh with the community neighborhoods of East Hills, Garfield, Homewood, Larimer, Lincoln, Leamington, Belmar, and Wilkinsburg, which is outside of the city of Pittsburgh, the Hill District, several Mon Valley communities, including Clareton, North Versailles, Duquesne, McKeesport, North Braddock, Braddock, and Rankin, and the north side of Pittsburgh. In these communities, we see higher rates of chronic diseases than in the rest of the county. This is included in the testimony. You can see, for example, when you look at diabetes averaged for the county, it is 10%. But if you look in all of the REACH communities that I mentioned, the rate is higher in terms of 17%. Another one that I will mention, this is included in your testimony, high blood pressure, for example, is 35% across Allegheny County. But in our REACH communities, we're seeing rates that are higher of 42%. Through a diverse coalition with more than 25 partners, including the University of Pittsburgh, as I mentioned, this project is increasing access to healthy foods and physical activity in these communities. Partners are providing breastfeeding supports and linkages between community organizations and residents and clinical organizations, such as the federally qualified health centers that Dr. Bogan mentioned in her testimony. The REACH Coalition has exampled various local inequities related to nutrition, physical activity, and access to care. Over the course of the five-year program, the coalition will focus on healthy food policies, new or improved pedestrian, bike and transit routes, and a pharmacist navigation and referral program as examples. The coronavirus pandemic is forcing families to stockpile supplies, but for many, not having access to healthy food is a very real concern. The department and the REACH initiative has begun to devise a nutrition strategy through partnerships with the Pittsburgh Food Policy Council, Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh, the Food Trust, Just Harvest, Healthy Start, and the Pittsburgh Black Breastfeeding Circle. Although the work was unrelated to this current crisis, the partners began to lay the groundwork for feeding more families and residents experiencing food insecurity. These are just some of the activities happening among REACH partners. The Pittsburgh Food Policy Council is sharing key resources for people, nonprofits, businesses across the food system. The Greater Pittsburgh Community Food Bank continues to monitor the development of COVID-19 and to take proactive steps to protect the community. Due to the logistics and observation of social distancing regulations, those in need of food can rely on the large network of food pantries. Just Harvest is issuing a call to action to the public to urge state officials to swiftly adopt key measures to protect working families and other vulnerable people during the COVID-19 pandemic. This is just a sample of some of the work that has been done in Allegheny County that aims to address health disparities. These actions contribute to reducing the proportionate impact of COVID-19 on communities of color in Allegheny County. Thank you for the time this afternoon to share this information with you, and I look forward to the opportunity to answer questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Hardy. Will you be able to stay around after our next testifier to answer any questions that the members may have?
Yes, I will be able to stay through this panel. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. We're going to continue on with Jessica Ruffin. Ms. Ruffin, are you on the line?
I am. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Thank you very much for joining us. You can begin your testimony.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to share and participate in this hearing, and a special thank you to Representative Frankel and his staff for the invitation. I was asked to share the Department of Human Services' role in the COVID-19 response, as well as to uplift some of the community concerns, particularly those of immigrant and refugee communities, due to our office's proximity to the Immigrant and International Advisory Council within Allegheny County. Early on in the pandemic, we at DHS, in partnership with the Allegheny County Health Department, recognized the importance of targeting and engaging communities that, because of other pre-existing conditions or community conditions and where they lived, were at higher risk of COVID and were going to be most negatively impacted by the mitigation strategies, including the stay-at-home order. We were also aware that our targeted communities also had less faith and trust in government and medical officials, which meant that we needed to navigate that, as well as a great deal of misinformation that had already reached some highly vulnerable communities that was resulting in folks not remaining in compliance with the guidance that has been provided. And so our targeted needs over the first few months of the response was around getting culturally responsive mitigation strategies to vulnerable communities, to communicate and gather feedback on decisions that have already been made that would impact these targeted communities, as well as establish a system for ongoing and thoughtful engagement around future processes, decisions, and implementations. And so just a couple of special initiatives and interventions that have taken place. We at DHS, in partnership with the Health Department, have cataloged guidance in over 100 languages, which is located on our website. We've also supported the Health Department in posting daily updates and guidance in the top 5 languages requested by clients of DHS in Allegheny County that is located on the Allegheny County COVID-19 website. We've collaborated with local organizations to train nearly 100 volunteers to serve as community health deputies to help folks gain access to resources and information. Early on, we also hosted 5 listening sessions, one with members of the faith community, with with folks that represent or serve the Black community, the Latinx community, refugees and immigrants, as well as folks that serve LGBTQ populations. As a result of those listening sessions, we established a COVID-19 advisory committee, and we are currently in the process of reconvening the advisory committee around our coronavirus response funds investments to ensure that we are actually getting information and resources to community-based organizations. So one of the things that we're starting to think about as we transition more towards relief and response are the residual impacts of COVID-19 on the human services system. So first and foremost, unemployment. It is, according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, it's estimated that 16.8% of folks in Pittsburgh's MSA were experienced a reduction in hours, and that is expected to increase in 2021. And it's also been shown that households that have earned under $40,000 have been hit the hardest. 65% have lost wages versus 41% for households that were earning more than $75,000 a year. Housing continues to be a concern. One in five renters reported not being able to pay their rent in August, according to Fourth Economy. And in May, 43% of all the calls that came into the United Way 211 were for rental or utility assistance. National surveys have shown that 36% of respondents say that COVID-19 has had a serious impact on their mental health, with 8% reporting an increase in alcohol and drugs. And symptoms of serious psychological distress is highest among young adults or adults with household incomes less than $35,000 per year. We also have seen reports that abuse and neglect also increases and is correlated with unemployment. The number of children who are hungry in Allegheny County is estimated to increase to 58%. And it's important to note that 23% of children in Allegheny County are already estimated to be food insecure. So to that end, Allegheny County's Department of Human Services coronavirus relief priorities include strategies to reduce the spread of to people at high risk of serious illnesses, and that includes folks that are in residential facilities, to increase access to services, as well as to ensure that services and basic needs are delivered in a safe way. So just to highlight a couple of concerns that came up during the community listening sessions, as well as our work with the Community Advisory Council. So first and foremost, there's a growing concern, and please note that these are for prioritizing concerns within immigrant and refugee communities. There's growing concern about access to public benefits. There is need to strengthen the front door to increase enrollment in public benefits, but also growing concerns around eligibility, particularly because members of that identify as undocumented have been disproportionately impacted by the stay-at-home orders or return to work. As Hannah stated, testing has often been a concern that has been raised. However, the community members cite that partnerships with FQHCs have been extremely helpful, and so the desire is for those partnerships to continue. Employment has also been a concern, and more specifically around workers' rights and a desire to have a clear process for reporting concerns or violations of workers' rights. Language access continues to be a barrier as far as information being shared, as well as folks' ability to be able to engage folks whose primary language is not English. There's also concern around continuous or inclusive COVID-19 data, ensuring that we are consistently reporting out on ethnicity, gender, and sexuality data so that folks that are in the community doing the work can continue to measure their progress and impact in those communities. Technology access was a huge barrier when thinking about how students were able to maintain engagement within educational system. Although there have been lots of efforts to increase food access, access to culturally acceptable foods continued to be an ongoing challenge for members, particularly of refugee communities. And finally, culturally relevant communication. That includes not just translated guidance as referenced above, but also making sure that folks are using appropriate channels for sharing culturally relevant information. So thank you so much to the committee for the opportunity to share our work as well as to uplift the ongoing community concerns. And I will be able to stay on for questions.
Great. Thank you very much for that, Ms. Ruffin. I think we'll begin with questions by the members who are present here at the hearing. So I'm going to start with Chairman Quartz. I believe you have a question, Chairman.
Thank you, Chairman Kinsey, and thank you all for your testimony today. Ms. Hardy, I have a question for you. For Dr. Bogan, in her statement here, we talked about the disparity on the amount of COVID deaths, tragically at 20%. Do you have the age range for this group? Is it mostly younger folks, or is it all over the map on age range?
You're asking about the death, the folks that that have passed away.
Yeah, the 20%. You said it's tragically we have a 20% increase in the COVID-19 deaths from Dr. Bogan's testimony.
Yes.
I assume you have the age breakdown for that.
We do have the age breakdown. I don't know that off the top of my head. I could get that to you, or if you wanted to proceed to other questions, that is all publicly available on our website. I can, but I would have to get that to you. I don't know that information off the top of my head, but I can probably get it here in pretty short order.
Okay, well, thank you. I'll move on to, if I may, Chairman Kinsey, one more question. Ms. Ruffin. Thank you for your testimony also. You mentioned that the children, 23% of the children in the county are estimated to be food insecure, which is a terrible number. It's shameful that we're even there. And you estimate that it's going to go up to 58%. The trend is moving up now. You see that right now, that the trend is increasing. Is that correct?
Correct. Those are from national reports from agencies such as Feeding America that due to the coronavirus, that food insecurity is forecasted to increase. Yes.
And it's directly related to the COVID-19 pandemic crisis?
Yes.
That's just a comment. It's just absolutely terrible. And we should not allow this to happen at all. I mean, children are being impacted by this. Well, thank you for your testimony. Thank you, Chairman Kinsey.
You're welcome, Chairman Quartz. Now we'll hear from Chairman Dan Franco, who has questions, I believe.
Yes, thank you. Thanks to both of you for your testimony, and to Dr. Bogan as well, who couldn't be with us today. Obviously, trying to mitigate and contain the spread and help in these communities, the strategies we're talking about are, the case investigations followed by the contact tracing. And you talked about culturally relevant communication. I think one of the things that concerns me is as you do the case investigations of people who are infected and then try and do the contact tracing that in these communities you have to, contact tracing is a complicated thing. We've seen the effectiveness of it in Allegheny County because we were able to identify bars as a particularly potent infection location. But it requires building a sense of trust with those that who have been infected and then those who have been contacted. How do we approach that? I mean, how do you find the people who are doing this work that have the trust in these communities that can do this in an effective way? Is that one of the criteria that you guys look at in terms of when you develop your contact tracing core? And also, how else do you deal with getting into areas where you might have undocumented immigrants who are going to be very, very wary of communicating with anybody or wanting to be identified as at all? So.
So I think the one question was about Representative Frankel about the contact tracing and how we kind of handle that in terms of finding people who are trusted in the community. Is that right?
Yes.
So we have hired, and I was just listening in on the Board of Health meeting. I mean, we have hired additional, 20-some case investigators and then additional contact tracers. And we do have assistance with other agencies. For example, the Centers for Disease Control is providing some assistance to us for help with the case investigations. So for the contact tracing, we are attempting to hire as many folks as we can to assist in that. I would say, as it relates to your second question, in terms of reaching some of the harder to reach populations, we're really working and trying to work as much with trusted community organizations as possible. So for example, Jessica and I were involved in specific discussions with a specific organization as it relates to targeting testing and things like that. And then we really rely on them to help get the word out about, for example, the testing sites or just the best practices information. I did also just receive an answer to the previous question about the median age of death. So let me just answer that before I cede the floor to Jessica to answer that question. The median age of those who have passed away is 84. So we have not really seen that come down yet in terms of the folks who are passing away from COVID.
Thank you, Hannah. And in response to the second question, yes, Representative Frankel, we've made really efforts to leverage some of our existing advisory groups that we've been working with. So I mentioned early on our Immigrant and International Advisory Council, which has been in place now in Allegheny County for 12 years. And so particularly with some of our immigrant and more specifically with our refugee communities, have really been working with the health department to connect them with respected and with community leaders. We also, as I mentioned early on, have been working with local organizations to actually train those community leaders on an ongoing basis to be able to provide support and resources to members of their community, considering that there is a lack of trust of government officials and health and health staff. Additionally, we've really been trying to work to establish a shared leadership model. And so while we, as county government, might be going to these organizations with concerns about spread within their communities, we really are working to co-design the strategies. And so, for instance, with some communities, we've learned that flyers or Facebook postings don't necessarily work. There are some communities that utilize social media, such as Facebook, to get information out, in which case we provided materials for that platform. There are other communities that are using applications such as the WhatsApp, that are used to outreach, and even some communities that have the capacity to do robocalls to large members of their community, in which case we'll provide scripts, assist with, and then they can assist us with the translation and distribution. And so, to answer your question about using the culturally relevant and culturally appropriate platforms, that is all determined using a shared leadership model.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Chairman Frankel. Before we go on to the next questioner, Just want to recognize that we've been joined here at the state capitol by Chairman Boyle. So, Chairman Boyle, thank you for joining us this afternoon as well. And with that being said, Representative Allman, I believe you have a question.
Thank you, Chairman Kinsey. Yes, I do. And actually, Chairman Frankel really breached the topic, so I just wanted to do some follow-up because I'm also interested in the obvious applications to my district, and that is, what guidance can you give us to make sure that we have appropriate educational outreach, mitigation, communication outreach for those of our citizens and our non-citizens, but our residents whose language, who have language barriers. Also, can you give us some guidance on making sure that the communication is there, as well as the support and contact tracing is there for people who are particularly sensitive because they're undocumented? So do you have some guidance you can share with us that's, because I'm concerned about especially the undocumented individuals. Thank you.
Sure, Hannah, I can get started. Or do you want to start, Hannah?
Well, the one thing that I would say, and then I'd like to let you discuss that, is I do feel that there, if you're looking for communications pieces, I feel like there's a lot out there. So I would encourage folks that, you know, from the Centers for Disease Control, there's so many, it's almost like there's so many communication pieces out there. And I will let Jessica speak to some of the translation work that we've done in Allegheny County, because I think that's a specific concern. But I do think that there is, what I would add is from public health, from our federal and state public health organizations, I feel like there's a lot of information out there. I think, and then I'll let Jessica talk about, you know, translation, how important that is.
Sure, absolutely. We're very fortunate within Allegheny County to have a fairly strong language access plan. And so when we initially started to deal with the pandemic response, we already had established relationships with language service providers that were eager to help us to assist with the translation of documents, as well as helping us to even think through our strategy for outreach. I will say, from a planning process, in looking at your infrastructure, I think the thing that has been most beneficial to us is having a pretty public feedback loop so that folks can reach out to us and let us know what it is that they need. And so we knew going on in this pandemic, and it was really a great pleasure to be able to partner with the health department on the community engagement piece, because we knew that while folks were concerned about the COVID response, which is the health department's responsibility, they were also very concerned about folks' access to benefits and access to resources that would help to sustain them during this crisis. And so that a lot of that work fell into our role at DHS. And so, again, as I mentioned before, early on, we were very intentional about hosting these community engagement listening sessions, just to learn a little bit more about what folks were seeing in communities, as well as really trying to learn from them what was the best way for us to get information out to them. And so I think I just can't overstate how important it is to make sure that community engagement is a huge part of that response, because those communities will tell you exactly what they need and also how and the best way to get information out to members of the communities. So
great, thank you for that. I think we'll finish up with any other members have questions. Okay, I have a question for each of you. This is Rep. Kinsey. And Hannah, my question towards you is, in your presentation, you talked about comorbidities as well as chronic diseases, and in your document, you sort of listed seven, starting with the heart disease and ended with smoking. Are you finding that the question would be, are there any comorbidities or chronic diseases that play a greater role versus the others? Like, otherwise, are you trying to address the comorbidities based upon the data that you have one by one? Are any of these chronic diseases playing a greater role than others in regards to, you know, the data and research that you have?
I think that's an excellent question. I don't think that we are there yet in terms of looking at the data. I think that's an excellent question to look at targeting that. I would say that we have not moved in that direction in terms of targeting specific chronic diseases, but that is definitely something that I will take back to our leadership.
I appreciate that because, again, you know, being a Black male and looking at my own family history, high blood pressure seems to be something that's pretty prevalent among, I'll say, my family, for instance. Diabetes may not necessarily be as prevalent, but it's something that, you know, folks that I'm around in my community have talked about throughout. You know, and looking at this physical inactivity, you know, maybe that comes in as we continue to get up there in age. You know, being a young kid growing up in Philadelphia, that wasn't a problem because when I was growing up, we used to run from folks anyway. So the physical inactivity didn't come until later on. You know, and smoking is something that exists that, you know, we've seen folks just trying to be cool and thinking, you know, at the age of 16, 15, it's cool to smoke, but we recognize that it's not a cool thing to do any longer. But would appreciate if there is some information that we can look at and work along with professionals such as yourself to try to pick apart one by one. You know, these chronic diseases that are impacting our community. So thank you again very much for that. And for Ms. Ruffin, the question I have for you is that, you know, I think you're aware that every single day the members here in the legislature, we receive information as it talks about new coronavirus cases throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. There's 67 counties throughout the Commonwealth, Philadelphia being the largest county, but one of the things that I've recognized over the past week is that the number of cases in Allegheny County has grown, I mean, has almost doubled the size of any other county throughout the Commonwealth. And recognizing that you're from Allegheny County working with the Department of Human Services, is there a reason that we're starting to see such an increase, particularly from Allegheny County, as it relates to number of new cases? Or is it because the numbers weren't counted accurately in the past? Or is there more testing being done? Like, what do you attribute the large increase in cases with the coronavirus from Allegheny County? What do you attribute that to?
Thank you so much for that question. I'm actually going to have to yield to my colleague Hannah to answer that because the health department is responsible for the response in Allegheny County.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
I would be glad to answer that to the best of my ability. And one other point that I wanted to make, Representative Kinsey, about the chronic diseases, I think one thing that we need to look at, given the nature of this virus in the lungs, and I was listening to information last night about just how it works in your body, I think that merits very specific focus as it relates to things like asthma and things like that.
Yeah,
you asked about the about the increasing numbers in Allegheny County, and if I could just be as passionate and as caring as possible in terms of bringing Dr. Bogan's voice to this, she is very concerned about this. They do. We have, through the case investigations and the contact tracings, you know, really pinpointed some very specific sources of these increases, part of which is, people have talked about this openly. When we went to green, people went to green. And so they have pinpointed a lot of our cases to bars and restaurants and unsafe behavior in those situations. They even, through the case investigations, can identify, you know, I think there's a list of 19 or so very specific locations in the county where really many of the cases are from. The other cause that we have identified as part of our case investigations is people that did, you know, whether it was on the Memorial Day holiday or otherwise, go to coastal locations. And so that has been, really as part of our case investigation, those are two things that we've really highlighted in the data.
Thank you for sharing that. And Ms. Ruffin, I'm sorry, I can't let you off the hook just yet. So, Ms. Ruffin, I want to go back to you, and this is actually a part of your presentation. You talked about it was a need number two, communicate and gather feedback on decisions that have already been made that will impact targeted communities. I'm thinking now, in the fact that we're in the midst of COVID, you talked about hosting 5 listening sessions to vulnerable communities. And I think you sort of touched on this a little bit earlier with my colleague, but I want to just get back to this because, again, recognizing that there's been an increase of numbers in Allegheny County and recognizing that there's such a disparity of health disparity throughout communities of color, you've hosted thus far 5 listening sessions. I'm not sure how what was the time frame with that, but, again, the fact that we're now in COVID, how do you still plan to get that information out there? I think I heard you talk about newsletters and maybe social media, but recognizing that, you know, some of these households may not necessarily have access to the internet like other communities. So is there a strategic plan to ensure that these communities of colors that will no longer be able to maybe just come to a sit-down session to get information? And so what's the strategy now to do the outreach?
Sure, absolutely. So a couple of things. So one, the listening sessions actually took place at the end of March, beginning of April. And so we were currently under, at that time we were under stay-at-home order. So all the listening sessions were actually hosted virtually. As a result of those listening sessions, we did identify members of a COVID, what we're calling the Allegheny County COVID-19 Advisory Committee, which is a group of about 20 folks that represent everything from workforce development agencies. They work with community groups that serve these specific targeted communities, as I mentioned. We had particular interest to learn more about the needs of the Black community, the Latinx community, other immigrant groups and refugee communities, as well as LGBTQ communities. And so we do have representatives on the advisory council that regularly serve those communities, as well as folks such as Dr. Gary Webb, who is on the second panel, who work who are public health scholars that are guiding our efforts. And so that group, we are hoping to continue to engage on an ongoing basis. And based on the advisement of that group, if we did need to host additional listening sessions virtually, they went really, really well. The last time we had over 100 people actually call in across all 5 of the listening sessions and engage. And so we can certainly revisit that as well. But the hope was that the ongoing feedback would come from the advisory council. And so that's the mechanism that we're continuing to utilize.
Great. Thank you very much. And I believe we have no other questions from the members that are present, as well as the members who are listening virtually. So on behalf of the Policy Committee, the Health Committee, and the Pennsylvania Legislative Black Caucus, I want to thank each of you, Dr. Bogan, Hannah Hardy, and Jessica Ruffin, for your testimony. There's no doubt that the information that you shared with us today will help us provide framework as we continue to move forward as legislators to assist the folks throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So again, thank you very much for your testimony. And we're going to move right into the testimony of our second panel. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe that would include Dr. Tyra Bryant Stevens, Dr. Tiffany Gary Webb, Megan Hume, and Corey Coleman. And hopefully all 4 testifiers are with us, still with us. And if so, we can begin with hearing a testimony of Dr. Tyra Bryant Stevens, if you're there. Dr. Bryant Stevens?
Yes, I am here. I'm having trouble with the video piece. It won't come on for some reason.
We can still hear you, Dr. Bryant Stevens. So, yeah, we'd love to see you, but as long as we can hear you, that's more important.
Okay. Well, I want to thank, first of all, the organizing committee, Representative Frankel, for him and his team for inviting me to share with you today. By way of introduction, I'm a primary care pediatrician and the medical director of the Community Asthma Prevention Program, affectionately known as CAP, at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. And since its inception, CAP has sought to understand the root causes of asthma disparities. 23 years ago, We realized that despite practicing guideline-based care, our patients had three times the number of hospitalizations and emergency room visits as compared to the national average. Most of our patients are African American. The traditional medical practice of just prescribing medications wasn't working, nor was the traditional practice of blaming the patient for not being compliant. I personally was convinced that we, the medical community, had to be missing something because the parents I served cared about their children and would really do anything they could to prevent them from having asthma symptoms. So in fact, perhaps the fault was ours for not identifying and addressing the root cause of asthma disparities. I believe that these lessons that we've learned in addressing asthma disparities can be applied to the disparities we are currently seeing in the COVID-19 pandemic outcomes, where hospitalizations and deaths are most often seen in Black and Brown patients. Unfortunately, COVID-19 has magnified the root causes, which are grounded in structural and institutionalized racism that pervades city, state, and country. And such practices include redlining, geographical segregation, poor housing, lack of healthy food, blaming the victim in terms of education and criminal justice, and more. One of the major lessons that I've learned is really to listen to the residents of our community, and I congratulate Ms. Ruffin on the same. And some of the things that we always ask is, what are their concerns and fears? How do we remove barriers? How do we provide resources? Where do we need to build trust, and how can we build trust? And one of the most important things I've learned is that reducing any kind of health disparities requires listening to those most impacted and getting boots on the ground to identify and address those root causes. So with CAP, we have a team of 16 community health workers who are people who are members of the communities we serve. And we have been speaking to about 400 parents of children diagnosed with asthma in the past 3 months regarding their COVID-19 concerns. And I just wanted to share with you some of the things that we're hearing. One is that people are afraid. They're afraid of going to the hospital or emergency room because that's where COVID is. They're afraid of the germs and the exposure to more germs. They're also afraid to take their children to primary care and themselves to primary care. And they want assurances that the facilities are clean each day. Adults are also afraid of the stigma associated with COVID-19, especially if they have to work in order to provide for their families. So why would they get COVID testing without some reassurance that they will not lose their job or that resources for daily survival are available? They're also concerned that the city is opening too soon. Should they trust that public health professionals care more about their health than businesses? People are overwhelmed with the schools and childcare centers closed, and what they now have to do in terms of monitoring their child's education, their sleep, their activities, as well as their jobs. And they're frustrated with the barriers for testing. Needing a doctor's note, an appointment, is a barrier that is really hard for people who are trying to juggle all of these different activities. The whole PPE process is also a little scary for them, and they're afraid that the test is painful. And people are finally confused, and we've discussed that before, which is that they are hearing different messages from both from the media, health professions, and government. And since they don't know who to trust, they don't trust anyone. So based on this, my experience and this information, I really think we have to focus on a few things. One is we need to remove barriers. And the previous discussant talked about working with FQHCs, which is something we've done in Philadelphia in the health department. We've also used them as testing sites. And that does remove the barrier of location because many of them are located in the communities of color. But there are other barriers that we do need to address. We need to make sure that anyone who wants COVID testing can be tested without appointment or prescription. We should offer walk-up as well as drive-up testing. And we should make sure that the screening is available in different languages. Also, a suggestion I would make, given my experience, is to utilize community health workers and or community residents to spread messaging about COVID-19 and motivate more people to be screened. We actually did this 10 or 12 years ago. We went door to door in over 2,000 homes to find out the prevalence of asthma, because what we were seeing in our office is not what we were hearing and not what was reported by national data. And we discovered that in communities of color, that instead of 14% prevalence, it was really 25 to 26% prevalence, of asthma. So community health workers can be used to get real information in real time. And then, you know, we really need to directly intervene to eliminate root causes of poverty. This will address not only COVID-19 disparities, but reduce and ultimately eliminate disparities in other chronic diseases, which predispose Black and brown people to have more severe outcomes from infections such as COVID-19. And I know that poverty is big, and I often hear that it's too big, but we do know that education, good housing, good food lifts people out of poverty. So it's a choice that we need to make to reallocate funding to specifically address some of these structural issues. We've started at CHOP where we are partnering with the housing repair organizations to do structural repairs in homes and low-income homeowners for children with asthma. Also, you know, we know that there's people, there are different people who are organized to give food, such as nonprofits and Medicaid managed care organizations. And there really needs to be a systematic way of making sure that every food desert has food and healthy food available. And last but not least, schools are very important. I've worked with schools in Philadelphia to bring asthma resources. And one time I was doing asthma teaching, and I found that the it was raining outside and was raining inside. So that really, the poor conditions of schools really prohibits kids from learning whether they have asthma or not. And then in summary, I would like to just go through a couple of more recommendations. We should have COVID tests available for all Pennsylvania residents with emphasis on racial and ethnic minorities at no cost with no barriers. We should fund community-based education and personal wellness initiatives by utilizing community health workers. Create a plan and develop resources to address structural racism issues such as poor housing and poor school conditions so that the next pandemic or the next infection does not, we do not see the same kind of disparate outcomes. And partnering with community health or community-based organizations has already been shown to work, and it sounds like Allegheny County has been doing that. One of the things that we hear a lot about is working and not having sick leave. So all employees should have access to paid sick leave, and I appreciate those things that have been done so far in the state to help with that, but that needs to be really across the state for all employees. And then developing a culturally competent, appropriate, responsive, multi-component model to address COVID-19 testing barriers. And then I will just end with the last one because I know I'm reaching my time. I think it is really important to create a Pennsylvania COVID-19 comprehensive strategic plan that educates racial and ethnic minorities on the serious impact of the virus, the importance of PPE, and access to PPE in low-income communities. So I want to thank you very much for this opportunity and happy to take questions later.
Dr. Brian Stevens, thank you very much for that, and thank you for hopefully staying around to address questions from the members. With that being said, we're going to move on to Dr. Tiffany Gary Webb. If you're there, Dr. Webb.
Yes, I am. I'm sharing my screen.
Great, we can see it.
Okay, great. Thank you for inviting me today. I'm Tiffany Gary Webb. I'm Associate Professor of Epidemiology at the University of Pittsburgh School of Public Health. And I'm here today to talk about a health equity response to COVID-19 in Allegheny County and about the work of our Black COVID-19 Equity Coalition. So Hannah Hardy talked a little bit about the disproportionate rates of chronic diseases such as diabetes, heart disease, and other conditions that have been linked to COVID-19 severity. So even prior to the COVID-19 pandemic, we've already had these inequities, and COVID-19 has basically magnified the existing inequities in the Black community. So related to COVID-19, we have lack of robust and equitably accessible testing capabilities, a lack of adequate reporting for testing cases and deaths by race, and in Black communities, we have a disproportionate concentration of in-person critical workers, in the neighborhoods that are most affected by these deficits in testing and information. And as we have seen, unfortunately, the color of COVID-19, that we've seen the disproportionate rates and deaths for Blacks. So this is nationally in PA State and in our county and Allegheny County. So one of the major root causes, as someone else mentioned, as to why COVID-19 would be ravaging Black America is systemic racism. So some of the inequities that already existed, for example, in housing discrimination, in lack of access to health care, in high rates of mass incarceration, these have all created conditions that have allowed higher risk of COVID in African-American populations. So there have been, in Allegheny County, a group of us who had been thinking about the disparities, and two community organizations, One Hood Media and Urban Kind Institute, that started basically a virtual town hall discussion to discuss what Black Pittsburgh needs to know about COVID, and to try to get information out there. I served as the first guest on the town hall, and at that time, we were asking for data on race and ethnicity to be public in Allegheny County, from our Allegheny County Health Department. At the time, it was not. The town halls get a very, very positive response. At some points, over 30,000 views have been, viewers have watched the sessions. They're weekly. The next session focused on testing capabilities in Black communities, and that was on Wednesday, April 22nd. So this work really sparked a number of us in Pittsburgh to develop the Black COVID-19 Equity Coalition. We're a group of concerned doctors, researchers, epidemiologists, practitioners, grant makers, government officials, focused on a number of principles related to health equity, and here they are listed here. So just to give you a few, we employ a health equity lens to a lot of the data that is coming out. We are tracking data coming out of state and local public sources and producing culturally relevant data. We're addressing institutional racism and structural impediments. And one of our major accomplishments is working with the federally qualified health centers, as Hannah mentioned earlier. So our task force is comprised of a number of working groups. So we have a data working group, a health equity task force that has a testing working group that works on testing strategies. We have a Black Business Task Force, Pittsburgh Black Elected Officials Task Force, and then, as Jessica Ruffin mentioned, the Allegheny County Health Department and DHS COVID Advisory Committee, which a number of us sit on that committee as well. So from our data working group, we really worked to try to do a strategic approach to testing in Allegheny County. So before the federally qualified health centers were providing testing, UPMC and Allegheny Health Network, the big health plans in our area, had testing sites. And if you could see those indicated by the green dots on the right graph. And what we noticed on the left graph is we mapped Pittsburgh and Allegheny County, and the green areas are predominantly Black neighborhoods. And as you can see, the testing sites in the region were not really near communities that were mostly Black. And so you can see the blue dots, which are the federally qualified health centers that are nicely located in predominantly Black communities. So we have developed, our plan is very strategic. It's very lofty. We are proposing to use the federally qualified health centers to do targeted testing, which we've already accomplished, and to participate in some of the contact tracing. We're using strategic collaborations to provide wraparound services. So we are connected to a number of different community-based organizations that are on the ground serving our population. We want to, again, work on culturally competent and sensitive contact tracing. And so we feel that our coalition and the federally qualified health centers can add to that process. And overall, our framework focuses on the social determinants of health. And so after COVID, we will be able to focus on some of the disparities that have already existed. So this type of coalition is being designed to live beyond COVID. So this is our timeline. It's very small, and it's not meant to be read, but it's just to say that from March, when Governor Wolf put in the stay-at-home order, all the way to current, we have been involved in a number of activities. A couple of our major accomplishments were the One Hood Media town hall about what Black Pittsburgh needs to know about COVID that I talked about. This equity coalition was the driver of the partnership that created the partnership between the Allegheny Health Department and the federally qualified health center. So we were, you know, initiating that collaboration. And so that has worked well. And that was in May. Since then, we have been meeting with a lot of PA state department officials to really discuss our coalition and how our coalition can really expand across the state and how we can all be thinking about the data structure, data infrastructure, and the data needs that are critical in monitoring this pandemic, particularly for vulnerable populations. And then we've been involved in media articles, webinars, and so forth, just to really get the message out about the disproportionate impact of COVID-19 in Black communities. So lastly, I just wanted to show you some of the data that we have been looking at. And so this is data reported a little differently than is reported on the Allegheny County Health Department dashboard. This is looking at the number of COVID cases per 100,000 population. And as you can see, from April to, this is data as of yesterday, the blue line are data for Blacks. They are case rates per 100 population. You can see that from the beginning, it has been disproportionate. And when you reach the kind of reopening phase in late June, early July, you can see a huge spike for Blacks, which is very disturbing. On the graph on the right is showing the ratio for Blacks to whites, and the orange is ratio of Asian to whites. As you can see also from the beginning, the case rate has been pretty much around 2 times higher than whites. And as you can see at the end, it is very much higher, almost getting to 3 times higher. So, you know, this narrative now is that we have these disproportionate rates. Hannah also talked about, we know in cases, Hannah also talked about the disproportionate rates in hospitalizations and deaths. We know we have more critical workers in the area and in these communities. And then there's also potential underreporting of deaths. So are all of the deaths that are happening, the excess deaths, being attributed to COVID. So we know there's disproportionate impact. And so we really think interventions now are desperately needed. We are open to collaboration to help think through how we can really get some interventions. But the narrative is clear now. And so now we really need to take action. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gary Webb. There's no doubt there'd be questions for you as well. Are you able to stay around? We have 2 more testimonies.
Yes, I am.
Great. Thank you very much for that. And we'll come back to you in the questioning section. Next week, we're going to hear from Megan Hume. Megan, are you still on the line?
Yes, I am.
Great. You're welcome to begin your testimony. Thank you very much for joining us this afternoon as well.
Thank you, and thank you for having me. So my name is Megan Hume, and I am the health coordinator at CAIAS Pennsylvania, which is a nonprofit that provides legal and social services to low-income immigrants in the Philadelphia region. In the fall of 2010, a 9-year-old refugee girl in Philadelphia caught the flu. Because of a pre-existing autoimmune disorder, the common flu nearly killed her. Further complicating her already fragile health, doctors and nurses had to heavily rely on telephonic language interpretation to communicate with the family, as there were no in-person interpreters available in the native language. I've spent quite a bit of time thinking about that little girl since early March. The flu kills upwards of 61,000 Americans a year, including previously very healthy people. COVID-19 is 10 times more deadly than the flu. For the past decade, I have borne witness to the significant barriers for immigrants attempting to access healthcare in the United States. My clients, I've spent countless hours in emergency rooms and doctor's offices. And all of this time, despite progress in technology and policy, the U.S. healthcare system remains largely unchanged. Since 1996, we have seen the erosion of life-sustaining programs and policies for those on the margins of our society. Welfare reform slashed the social safety net and created a system that reinforces poverty instead of alleviating it. While imperfect, the Affordable Care Act enabled millions more residents to access healthcare and yet is constantly undermined and under threat. These changes have resulted in some staggering statistics. 34 million U.S. citizens live below the poverty line. Maternal mortality is on the rise, and Black women are even more at risk than their white counterparts. In 2018, 27.5 million Americans were uninsured, a number that is sure to grow in the coming months as over 44.2 million have filed for unemployment in the wake of the coronavirus pandemic. Black Americans are 3 times more likely to die of coronavirus than whites. COVID-19 has laid bare the inadequacies of our system writ large. It has exacerbated the pre-existing conditions of America: inequality, poverty, sexism, xenophobia, racism. I was asked here today to this distinguished group about how the COVID-19 crisis is impacting immigrants here in Pennsylvania. Immigrants in the Keystone State are not a monolith. Each population is comprised of vastly intersecting identities that span geographical origin, race, age, gender, family situation, and sexual orientation and gender identity. Just like their U.S.-born counterparts, they too are at the mercy of a system. Immigrants are 7.3% of Pennsylvania's population and are not only vital to our economy, but also our lives. For 7% of our nurses and nearly 12% of our health aides are foreign-born. Low-wage immigrants are at higher risk for COVID-19, as they serve as many of our essential workers and are often denied paid sick leave and other benefits access. Immigrants with limited English proficiency were already subject to worse health outcomes than their U.S.-born counterparts before the pandemic. Compounding these challenges, there's an ongoing dismantling of our immigration system. Despite global need, refugee arrivals to the United States have been slashed to a paltry 18,000. The asylum system is being gutted. Residents are being stripped of their legal status, either through policy or intentional inefficiencies. Rampant fear of immigration and customs enforcement activities and confusion around xenophobic public charge policies have prevented Pennsylvanians from accessing healthcare, including COVID-19 testing and treatment. But what can be done? Since May of this year, I've had the pleasure of working on a task force under the Pennsylvania Department of Health's Office of Health Equity, wherein we developed 4 recommendations to alleviate some of the challenges of COVID-19 on immigrants. Through a survey of 130 immigrant service providers, including community-based organizations and extensive research, we drew up 4 recommendations. In the interest of time, I would like to discuss 2 of them here today. Just as the collection of race data has been instrumental in the understanding of and fight against the spread of COVID-19, we propose the assurance of language access in the collection of preferred language at testing sites across the state. Language access is a civil rights issue and one faced all too often by immigrants, particularly in medical settings. This is a unique opportunity for Pennsylvania. We could lead the country in data collection on preferred language, facilitating prevention of coronavirus spread in specific communities and allowing for more accurate contact tracing. As it stands, the collection of race data is a very welcome step, but race on its own is not nearly nuanced enough to tell the stories of the lived experiences of all Pennsylvanians in the face of our current global pandemic. Additionally, expanded testing and treatment access is a must for all Pennsylvanians. Testing sites have been labeled free, but unseen barriers are preventing people from testing. Many sites require insurance, require a doctor's prescription, require a car, or are not, in fact, free. There are many potential low-cost solutions to these issues. As part of a two-fold policy solution, we recommend following existing models. For example, the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium has proven in Philadelphia that local community-based testing sites can reach traditionally, quote-unquote, hard-to-reach populations to get tested. Mobile testing vans can become hubs of health in urban and rural settings alike and are already being utilized to reach migrant farm workers in other states. Expanded testing and treatment access necessarily includes treatment. Even prior to COVID-19, the uninsurance rate populations U.S. citizens. 23% of documented immigrants and 45% of undocumented immigrants were uninsured compared to 10% of U.S. citizens. We emergency Medicaid and cover COVID-19 testing and treatment, for it is one of the few forms of health insurance available to Pennsylvanians, documented and undocumented. The challenge of COVID is not exclusively that of a novel virus. It is a real and desperate need to dismantle the pre-existing conditions upon which the United States was built and the reality facing so many residents of Pennsylvania. We cannot afford to cede any more ground in this fight. The health of the entire country depends upon it. As much as I have been disheartened these last few months, I have also been inspired by my colleagues, my clients, and by you. Thank you for taking the time to convene, listen, and I look forward to questions and can remain on while we get there.
Great. Well, thank you very much for your testimony. And we just have one more testifier before we get to the questions. So thank you for being able to remain with us until we get to the questioning. Thank you again. And next, we're going to hear from Mr. Corey Coleman. Mr. Corey Coleman?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. And you can begin your presentation.
Great. Let me first thank Chairs Sterla, Kinsey, and Frankel for the opportunity to speak. Again, I am Corey Coleman. I am Vice President for Community and Strategic Partnerships for United Healthcare. I want to talk a little bit with you all today about the social determinants of health. And as I've listened to the presentations today, I think you will see a strong correlation between what's driving some of the mortality rates of COVID-19 on the African-American community in particular, and the correlation between that and the social determinants of health. For the members of the committee, let me just let you all know, I did shorten the slides, finding out that I think I have about 5 minutes to present. So I will quickly run through 10 slides that I have for you all. So again, the social determinants of health are really the factors that impact individuals' health that they contribute to and sometimes contribute to and don't know. These are environmental factors. These are things like eating a balanced meal every day versus not eating a balanced meal every day and what that can do in terms of your access to health care.
Excuse me, Mr. Coleman, we can actually hear you. I understand that when they tested earlier, they were able to see you. So it's your choice if you'd like to be seen as you're talking as well.
Sure.
Also, if you want to share his screen so that we can see his presentation. Because we have paper copies of it, but it's not online.
Okay.
Okay. Can you see me now?
Great. Okay, great. There you are.
All right.
Thank you.
And you can see the presentation, right?
We just see you. We do not see the presentation at the moment.
Let's try that again. Okay.
Yep. Great. Thank you.
Now we can, yeah.
Sure. So again, just talking a little bit about our social determinants of health strategy. So this is an issue that I would say nationally, all of the healthcare organizations throughout the country have really begun to think seriously about putting in place policies and resources, really, one, to identify the social determinants of health, and then to figure out ways to remedy the challenges that the community members we serve have. So what I want to do is provide you with a high-level overview over regarding our social determinants of health strategy. And so I'll let you know, we partnered with the National Association of Community Health Centers. This organization organized and led the concept of a PREPARE tool. The PREPARE tool is a screening tool that is in place throughout the country that allows organizations like United Healthcare and organizations like Community Health Centers to have a better sense of what the specific challenges members may have as it relates to social determinants of health. And so what we've done is we put in this process specifically for new United Healthcare members. And we really wanted to start with that smaller portion of the pie as it relates to our members to understand what are the challenges with the new members that come on to the United Healthcare Health Plan. So you can see the slide that I've provided you gives you a little bit of an overview of, one, the fact that we have 11 questions that we ask, and we'll go into some of those details in a previous slide. As we reach out to our members to ask these questions, to screen for social determinants of health, we have some tools that we are able to use at the moment a member identifies a social challenge that they may have. If a member lets us know that they're having a tough time with education, for example, we have a new GED benefit in place for all members. Once a member has identified, number one, I did not graduate from high school and I am interested in the GED program that you offer, we have the ability to connect that member at that time to the program coordinator to help provide the GED credits and benefits and trainings for that member. And I give you that as one example of what we're able to do by screening for these specific challenges our members have. Secondly, I want to give you a little bit of an overview. Now, the slide you're looking at now shows you a little bit of an indication of what we have learned thus far from the members we've screened. Remembering, again, the first thing I would say is we have roughly under 290,000 members in Pennsylvania, spanning generally from southwest to southeast across the southern half of Pennsylvania. And we're talking about a subset of a subset of a subset. So again, these are only new members. And so for new members, when they join our health plan, there is a outbound call. And that outbound call, we do what we call a health risk assessment. After a member completes the health risk assessment, we then ask 11 social determinant of health questions. And you can see starting in November, again, we started this program back in November, we've been able to really find out specific challenges our members are having throughout the state. And you can see by the map in the far right-hand corner that we have received information and specific data points around each of our members in all of the counties that are shaded in light to dark blue. These are just some of the indications we've seen. So number one, we didn't know before specifically what were the social determinant of health challenges that our members had. You can see that just looking at some of the data, the majority of our members have indicated that they have 3 to 6 needs. And that is the vast majority of the members we screen. So we know specifically what those challenges are. And when you know what the challenges are specifically, you're in place to be able to provide specific solutions for those specific problems. And the great thing about what we've been able to build here for our members that are challenged, you can see that what we've learned from screening our members is, and I'm looking at the chart in the right-hand corner that says needs identified by month. You can see that the number one need identified by our new United Healthcare Medicaid members is employment. The number one need, again, this is spanning from March, from February out to November. You can see employment is the number one need by far. So with that information, what can we do with it? So early this year, we moved forward with an employment support strategies for members screened. What we've been able to do, and I think this speaks to some of the challenges that we've heard from some of the other presenters regarding specific problems members have around employment and the fact that more and more people are in unemployed in Pennsylvania as a result of the COVID pandemic. And so we have identified what I consider to be preferred community partners throughout the state. You can see in the southwest section of the state, we have a partner, Fayette County Community Training Institute. We have a premier partner in Central PA, which is Tech Central, and a premier partner in Philadelphia, which is Southwest CDC. And these organizations specifically specialize in providing employment support services so that when a member identifies to us the fact that they're unemployed and that they're interested in employment support services, we have partners in the state who are in position to provide the specific training and support services that they need. I won't spend too much time on this other than to say we have other employment support programs in place, including a pilot that is built off of the back of the University of Pennsylvania's research that they had done a number of years ago, specifically around eligible Medicaid members throughout the state who are eligible to work and are not working. And that data point leads us to the city of Philadelphia, males from the ages of 19 to 34, and very similar to the broad screening program that I mentioned earlier. We did a couple of things. We sent out a number of letters to 2,500 of these individuals to make sure that they were aware that they had resources in their community, specifically around the CareerLink organization. And we also put in place a similar program where we have two separate partners specifically for that population in Philadelphia. So that would be the Philabundance organization and the CEO organization. The one thing I will call out about CEO is that this is an organization that specifically supports individuals who have formerly been incarcerated or in jail or prison. So this is a unique partnership, but we have the ability to support both groups in the city of Philadelphia. Just to close out, want to give folks a sense of some of the additional work we're doing around the social determinants of health and specifically what we're doing in response to the COVID pandemic. I will not read all of these to you, but needless to say that United Healthcare, along with a number of other organizations throughout the state, have really stepped up to provide as many resources and support as we can. We recently provided $100,000 for a homeless program that we have in the city of Philadelphia, and also a pretty substantial commitment that we provided out in Western PA. So I will stop now, but thank you all for the opportunity to speak, and look forward to your questions.
Mr. Coleman, I want to thank you very much for your presentation. I'm pretty familiar with United Healthcare, recognizing that they are located in the city of the first class. Had opportunity to meet with you as well as some of the administrators there, and do appreciate the work that you've been doing throughout. So thank you again, and you'll be able to stay for questions as well?
Absolutely. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. Okay, we'll begin with questions from the members who are present, and at the same time, we'll ask members who are listening virtually if they have questions. Chairman Boyle, I believe you have a question.
Thank you, Chairman Kinsey, and thank you for the panel for being here. I just more have a comment. I think that the for-profit healthcare system that we have in the United States has clearly perpetuated inequality in terms of COVID-19, and we specifically have seen that in communities of color. We all know the long history of racism in our country, which has led to the African-American community being poorer than people of a Caucasian background. So fundamentally, I think that we need to recognize that this whole experience that we are going through should inspire us all to try to change the healthcare system. Thank you, Chairman Kinsey.
Sure. Thank you also, Chairman Boyle. Next, we hear from Vice Chair Representative Hohenstein.
Thank you, Chair. I have questions in particular for Dr. Banks, Dr. Bryant Stevens. And there's a portion of your written testimony where you talk about making sure that community health workers have a living wage with benefits. And we're also, you also highlighted in a couple of spaces the need to have people that our communities trust, because if they end up not trusting anyone, then they're not getting any information. And I just want to ask you a bit of what are the challenges that you're seeing? Because I know for a lot of community health workers, those wages aren't living wages, and it's a difficult and frankly sometimes a decision that people make to stay at home, or they haven't been coming in to work during the pandemic because of the lack of a living wage, and also the lack of protection in dangerous situations on the front lines. And I'm wondering what you're seeing and what kind of things we can be doing to make sure that that those living wages are being paid. I'm just interested in knowing what your ideas would be on it.
Thank you for that question. Yes, many community health workers are paid per diem, meaning if they're not going to be working, they don't get paid. Many are paid with do not have benefits, and those who are paid are making less than $15 an hour, which is not a livable wage in the United States, and certainly not in Philadelphia. So we definitely expect that some of those workers are now out of work because most of them make home visits. So we're not making home visits if we have a stay-at-home order. And now that we're in the green zone, there's still some reluctance for both the client and the community health worker to be in the home. We have started going back into the home of some of the children. We believe that this, what we do in terms of the relationship with community health workers who provide not only education, but social support, psychosocial support is critical, especially when you're dealing with a serious disease like asthma. So we are doing some home visits with a lot of precautions, but for the most part, we've been doing video visits. And the problem with video visits, as you can imagine, is if there is the digital divide or the lack of smartphones or the lack of data minutes. So there are a lot of barriers, I think, now for the community health worker to do their job. And so they can potentially be out of work, and they can potentially, and they still continue to make less than livable wages. So I do think there has been a recent certification process that's been approved for Pennsylvania, but I think with that, there needs to be some mandate around the salary as well as a career ladder. Right now, one of the things that many programs face is that community health workers turn over every year or even less than a year, and that's because of two things. One, they're not getting benefits, but also it's what's next and how long am I going to do this and what's the career ladder. So I think there are a lot of things around that. I think the great thing about community health workers, the reason I've been using and working with them for 23 years, is that they are able to make those relationships that no matter how much we care or want to, we're not able to do because people trust people who look like them, who understand their neighborhoods, who understand their stressors, and who have overcome, which many of these community health workers have done.
Thank you very much. I actually would ask if Megan Hume might comment a little bit on the use of community health workers in that last point that Dr. Bryant just mentioned, you know, folks, you know, looking and sounding like them.
So what I think I heard, just because you cut out a little bit at the end, was just talking about the use of community health workers, but also sort of the situation on the ground as it stands. Is that correct?
Yes.
So at our agency, we tend to use staff, some of which are part of the community, but some of which are like, I do believe that community health workers have a really important place in this conversation. I will say there are some populations or some subsets of populations that community health workers aren't always necessarily appropriate, especially in like the queer and LGBTQIA communities. One person from that population might not always be an appropriate person to do some of the outreach with those subsets. I will say right now on the ground, I'm going out to doctor's offices and into family homes, and it has been a lot less comfortable than I think we would have wished. I think that is sort of the nature of the direct services portion. I think anybody doing this work definitely deserve a fair wage and living wage and access to benefits. We find that especially a lot of folks that are responsible on the outskirts, not direct doctors and not direct nurses, but our home health care aides to be very close to the data holistically wrapped. But yes, I do fundamentally support community health workers, and right now it is quite hard. I want to echo the comments that televisits are not necessarily immigrant population, particularly refugees and those who have limited English proficiencies. It's quite hard to get through all of the different steps to actually get access to a doctor. So really trying to think creatively around some more community outreach, a necessity.
Thank you.
Great. Next we hear from a question from Representative Isaacson.
This is directed towards Tyra Brunt Stevens. I see you're a member of the Philadelphia Health Department, and we have been discussing today the inequities in our healthcare system. And certainly we all recognize, especially during this pandemic, how vast it is, especially whether it's language barrier or dealing with health problems or the systemic poverty or the fact that many households are single-family households run by women who are underpaid. But I also wanted to talk about education as we're trying to see about getting the children in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania back to school, especially since they lost the latter half of last year, the slippage. We really do need to find ways to make sure they're educated and safely. Is the Department of Health working in conjunction with the Department of Ed or the school districts to address the health issues that are going to come with opening of schools? Because, I mean, we already had a problem with dealing with health care and children in schools, and certainly it's going to be exacerbated by not just going back to school and the conditions, but also the fact that these children are, and the teachers and everybody else is going to have to wear masks.
Thank you for that question. I will say I am on the Board of Health, so I'm not a member of the Health Department, but I am on the Board of Health. And in answer to your question, yes, the Health Department is working with the school, and I believe today that at least the Philadelphia School District released their plan in terms of children going back to school.
Thank you, Representative Isaacson, and thank you for the question as well as the answer. We have Chairman Frankel on the line who has a question. Chairman Frankel, can you hear us?
Yes, thank you, Chairman Kinsey, and thank you to the panel for really very helpful testimony. And I'll throw this out to anybody. I mean, one of the things that we know has been, a result of the rising unemployment is that we have a record number of people who have lost their health insurance. 5.4 million was the last number. I think the largest increase we've ever seen at one in one short period of time. You know, and one of the things that I think I've heard anecdotally from folks is that, you know, that many of these people would have would be able to enroll in Medicaid, would be able to go to through the Affordable Care Act, but they're so overwhelmed with dealing with, you know, foreclosures, being evicted, or finding food for their families, looking for health care coverage is kind of like takes a back seat. Is that something you're seeing out in the community, and are there efforts made to do some outreach to make sure that people have coverage, particularly when they have opportunities to do that?
Yeah, so I was going to say, I would let my colleagues who are more in the social services department answer that. But one thing I did want to mention is, again, the partnership with the Federally Qualified Health Centers, because that has brought testing to those who don't have insurance. And so it also brings care during the pandemic, and after the pandemic, it will be an infrastructure to care for people. And so there are some federal resources coming to support them, but they are also, like some of the other community organizations and so forth, are going to be overwhelmed and are going to need more resources to handle all that need.
Yeah, and I would just like to echo that the federally qualified health centers across the state, many of them actually employ a staff member or more than one that is a benefits navigator, benefits counselor. With health centers, there are these hubs of care, but also hubs of enrolling in benefits that they qualify for. I also want to say that there are a number of organizations in the state of Pennsylvania that are able to either help enroll particularly children, but also adults in qualified benefits, particularly around medical care. The Benefilly hotline is not just in Philadelphia. It really does do some work extended outside of Philadelphia. There's also the PCCY. There are a number of different hotlines where you can call in and get some assistance. That being said, as was just said, it's actually quite difficult. The staffing is low. We're all working from home. And there is a complication in trying to actually get these resources set up. Phone calls take a little while to get back to. So I will say that there is definitely a need for it. I think also a public awareness raising would be very helpful, especially around Medicaid for folks that actually apply for it. I find that a lot of people do not know that it exists and that they qualify for it. So public awareness would be very helpful in that. That and actually also food stamps enrollment as well.
Great. Does anyone else want to address that? Okay. Thank you, Chairman Franco, and thank you for the responders to that question. I'm going to close out with a question for each testifier. So I'm going to begin with Dr. Bryant Stevens. Dr. Bryant Stevens, in your testimony, you talked about people are afraid. How do we address it? How do we alleviate fears? And I'm asking this question specifically because as legislators, I think someone testified earlier that, you know, some folks just don't trust politicians. They see what's happening at the federal level. And here in Pennsylvania, you know, they've seen us on the House floor having conversation about the opening versus not reopening the Commonwealth too quickly. We've seen what has happened in other states. Who are they to trust, but how do they also overcome the fear?
So my thoughts and some of the things that we've tried to do around this is to address their fears straight on. For example, we actually give them information about what the cleaning process is in the hospital so that if they're worried about it, they're not. One of the things that we've seen, you know, for children is that children don't to be as impacted as the adults. So there's really, you know, very little reason to fear going to the emergency room if your child is sick. We don't want you to wait till the last minute when it becomes a 911 emergency or wait to call your doctor. So I do think that, but I think the message delivery is really important. So it has to be by trusted people. So like you said, they don't trust everybody, but you have to find the people they trust. They do tend to trust, you know, community health workers. They tend to trust, if they have a faith leader, they tend to trust them. There are, you know, block captains that they trust. I think utilizing those trusted individuals to spread the message is really the most effective way to allay those fears.
Okay. Does that also help folks overcome the stigma, in your opinion?
Of having COVID? Yes. I think the way you overcome that stigma is for there to be some assurance about their jobs. For example, some businesses have had to, you know, if a person has tested positive for COVID, they're off without pay, and then they have to quarantine without pay. And so if you have an asymptomatic carrier, there's no reason they would want to get tested if that's going to mean losing their job and their ability to provide for their family. So removing the stigma is really, you know, deeper than that. It's really thinking about what benefits, what kind of assurances that they can have that this, you know, this doesn't mean that their kids can't eat. And I think someone mentioned about services. I do think that's helpful. You know, I realized from years ago from our community health workers that people just aren't aware of the services. So one of the questions that we also asked that I didn't talk about is what services do you need that you don't have? And for everything they said, we could find a service for them. So there was really nothing that wasn't out there. It was just that they didn't know about it, at least for what, you know, the ones that they told us about. So I do think sometimes is that messaging and that communication, how we can get folks who are, you know, who are in their homes and they're quarantined and they're not, you know, they're afraid to look at news anymore because the news just makes them more afraid. Sure. How do we get those other important messages out about resources?
Great. Thank you very much for sharing that, Dr. Brian Stevens. I'm going to skip. I want to go to Ms. Hume. Ms. Hume, in your testimony, you talked about proposed the assurance of language access and a collection of preferred language at testing sites across the state. Ms. Hume, roughly how many languages are we talking about in regards to adequately serving the general population at testing sites, roughly?
I would say across the state, around 50, upwards of about 100 if we wanted to get very specific.
So if we're looking at 100, then we would basically, if we want to ensure that we're serving all of the folks around the Commonwealth, then we are basically looking at the number of 100 different languages.
And possibly more. I would say 100 core languages. I will say, I think this was mentioned in the first panel, a lot of these resources do exist. There's also telephonic interpretation, which is not as good as in person. But understanding that if you need to serve populations that speak Arabic, Urdu, and Vietnamese all in one day, that you probably can't get community health workers or in-person interpreters to be there all day. And so instead, utilizing telephonic interpretation is a fairly good half measure, or like it actually is pretty effective. And then I will say a number of these resources already do exist in terms of flyers and prevention information, both in the state of Pennsylvania and also from like national immigration serving agencies as well.
Great, thank you for that. And you know, I want to commend you. You mentioned you used the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium as an example, and I've had the pleasure to work with Dr. Sanford as well as Reverend Marshall Mitchell as they provided testing at locations throughout my legislative district. But I also note that you talked about testing should be free, and I believe that one of the barriers, if I don't quote me on this, but I recall Dr. Sanford talking about the cost of the tests. The folks that lined up outside that Saturday morning at the church, some had insurance, some did not have insurance. So when we label this thing, this testing sites are labeled free, and you talked about unseen barriers, I mean, you mentioned down here, I didn't even think about like a car or something of that nature, but I know when folks showed up, I think everybody who showed up was actually tested, so therefore I'm assuming that the testing was free, but you're saying beyond folks just getting the test, there are other barriers that you would include into the cost, so to speak. Is that how am I interpreting this correctly, or?
So there's a few barriers that have really prevented, even in Philadelphia, but when we conducted the survey, realizing that trying to get testing in Erie is very different than getting tested in Philly. However, even at the federally qualified health center, in Philadelphia specifically, testing is free or on a very affordable sliding scale, and they also have insurance. But if you are not a pre-existing patient, you cannot really set up an appointment to actually get a test. And the wait times to become a patient at a health center in Philadelphia are anywhere from 2 to upwards of 4 or longer. So when we're talking about areas where these pre-existing spaces are already in existence. Locations. And then there are a number of CVS and Rite have undertaken quite a task testing.
Okay, Ms. Hume, you're actually going out. We're just getting like the first word of your sentence, and then you're fading out.
I'm terribly sorry. Is this a little bit better?
This is a little bit better, yes.
Okay. So the federally qualified health centers, you have to be a pre-existing patient, at least in Philadelphia, which is an issue. And then when we talk about CVS and Rite Aid, which have done a lot of work getting involved in a number of communities of testing sites, they unfortunately all currently require a car. And then a number of the urgent care facilities that do testing either require a car or do cost money if you do not have insurance, upwards of $150 or more.
Okay.
So, and if you're uninsured and you need, and you get through to Jefferson or Penn for the testing, you have to pay for the telehealth visit before you can go to one of their sites, which can be about $50. So even if testing is not literally free, it would be at least more accessible, $15, $25,
right.
Would go a long way.
I got you. Well, thank you very much for sharing that. I'm going to jump to Dr. Gary Webb. I'm blown away with this presentation with the Black Pittsburgh's COVID-19 Task Force. You just heard me reference the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium in Philadelphia. Have you worked directly with that organization? Sharing information?
So we haven't worked directly with them, but we do have members that are in touch with them. And so we're hoping, and we've been in touch with individuals at this PA State Health Department. And so their equity officer is making connections between groups that are working in different parts of the state. And so we do hope to be able to connect to Philadelphia, Erie, and other parts of the state.
I thank you for that. And what I found out in Philadelphia is that many of us individually have worked with the Black Doctors Consortium, but we've not doing it in a concerted effort. We've had conference calls with them. But when I look at the presentation that you shared, I mean, you're, in my opinion, head and shoulders above what our individual conversations have led to. So if you don't mind, I'm going to make sure that we get your information and maybe through the Pennsylvania Legislative Black Caucus, see if we can do some connection between the work that you're doing in Pittsburgh, the work that's being done by Black Doctors COVID Consortium in the Southeast area, and see how we can be helpful to that as well. And I share that because I know that the Pennsylvania Legislative Black Caucus did share with Governor Wolf a request for dollars to support the work that they're doing in the Southeast region, and also recognizing that there's a need not just in Southeast Pennsylvania, but also across the Commonwealth. So it'd be great to see if we can maybe connect, get information from you, how you're doing, what you're doing, find some resources that can support the organizations similar to the work that you're doing all across the Commonwealth. So we will make sure that we reach out to you, and just want to say thank you very much for sharing this. I think that there's such a need, and especially I share this because not just looking at the numbers from Allegheny County where the numbers have gone up, but I think one of the testifiers earlier had mentioned that, you know, this fall we're looking at another spike across, you know, not just the state here, but all across the United States and other parts of the world. So it's imperative that we do everything that we can to try to slow the spread as well as prepare for the next wave that's coming in. And it seems as though you guys have a plan to help address that. So we look forward to working with you. And thank you very much for your presentation today.
Thank you. Great. Appreciate it.
Mr. Coleman, we're going to close out with you. As I mentioned, I've had the opportunity to visit United Health and hear of the great work that United Healthcare is doing. I was a little bit, I guess I had a question as it relates to the screening. You talked about the screening for new members. What had interested me is that as time goes on, new members become, for lack of a better word, old members or older members. And so as needs change, challenges change, how does an organization like United Healthcare, how do you adapt to those changes that individuals are dealing with? You know, transportation might be an issue at one point in life, but then it's resolved. Employment might be an issue at one point in life, and it might switch to food insecurities. How do you still address those needs of those members?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for the question. I think this is an evolution, right? The healthcare industry, for the most part, has not focused in on social determinants of health as a focal point. And so as a part of the evolution, what I would say is that we will be evolving our strategies, one, to understand the specific challenges our members have, and more importantly, being able to respond to what those challenges are. So right now, we're focused on new members that will evolve into our existing members, which will likely evolve into a yearly screening program that could involve or evolve into a bi-weekly or bi-yearly screening. So I think the fact of the matter is the fact that we have put this in place, this is not something that is common in the healthcare industry to be screening for social determinants of health. This is a new dynamic across the country. I think there's only two or three states that even require a screening program in place for members, for any members. It doesn't even matter what the product line happens to be. So this is I think a new and evolving space that all of us will really have to understand and really adjust to as we learn more information about the challenges.
Well, Mr. Coleman, Ms. Megan Hume, Dr. Gary Webb, and Dr. Bryant Stevens, on behalf of the Policy Committee, the Democratic Policy Committee, the Democratic Health Committee, and the Pennsylvania Legislative Black Caucus, we want to thank each and every one of you for participating in our House Democratic Policy Committee hearing today. The information that you shared with us is insurmountable, and there is no doubt in my mind that members will be coming together to look at ways that we can institute legislation that can help the people throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So again, on behalf of Chairman Sterla, Chairman Frankel, all of the members who are here present today, the staff that put this together, as well as the members who are listening virtually, we want to say thank you very much, and we look forward to further conversation, whether it's individually or in a collective. The information that you shared is truly something that we can utilize, especially as we continue to deal with this pandemic and the impact that it's having on communities of color. So again, thank you all very much. Any closing comments from any of the members? With that being said, this will conclude our hearing. Thank you very much.